Okay, so the first topic of our major Britain, or our major British history, Brett study, which is the Britain Transform topic, it starts off with the first theme being about a changing political and economic environment, and obviously the first sub-theme within that is basically just a purely political overview of the period from 1918 to 1979, with a main focus on the extent to which the political landscape changes throughout that period, with a more in-depth focus, from what I can tell, on the interwar period where more actually does seem to change. And also kind of linked within that, the reasons behind why the political landscape is changing in this period. What I'll also add is, even, because I think quite a few people find this topic quite confusing, what I'll say is, it's one where even discounting the actual exam questions you might get specifically about changing political landscape, it's one which I've noticed, having taught the school for about 2 years now, that students who don't have a good grasp of the political history of this period in terms of who's in charge at what times, what kinds of overarching ideologies or principles are governing, or sort of the main ideological principles and ideas that are coming out of those particular governments or periods, it therefore becomes quite tricky to get a grip of what's going on throughout the entire time period in terms of other themes. So most themes in some way tend to focus on things that the government is doing, whether it's aspects of race relations, whether it's creation of various aspects of the welfare state, issues of union reform, etc. It's really quite confusing, especially when you start to consider getting a grip of all of those different changes, especially if you're unsure of who's in charge at what time and what overall ideas are kind of getting on this. Even, I'm mainly going to focus on what I think are sort of more common exam questions, but what I think you should probably do is get nailed down like a timeline of the period in terms of who's in charge at what periods, and you start to notice certain trends and patterns, and also within that, just briefly, what the kind of main policies that those governments kind of implemented. It would be quite useful if in that timeline you kind of added a summary of the economic things, the economic changes that they make, aspects of the welfare state, etc. And that will give a bit of structure at the spine to the rest of the course. So, this actually mainly going to focus on, or rather just going to focus on, the political environment itself and how far the political landscape or environment changes, and a little bit about the reasons why they do from 1918 to 1979. So, brief context of the political situation in the country in 1918. So, 1918, obviously Britain's just emerging from the First World War. During the First World War, Britain is governed by a wartime coalition of the Liberals and the Conservative Party. Labour is not in that coalition, they refuse to join it. That coalition is led by Lloyd George, by the end of the war that is, who is a Liberal Prime Minister. The Liberals having dominated British politics from before the war and basically the turn of the 20th century. So that's the context of who's in power at the time. It's a liberal-dominated coalition government with the Conservatives. In that same year, an important piece of legislation is passed called the Representation of the People Act. Really important you understand what it is and what it does. It's passed in 1918 and it basically expands the electorate to include a couple of other groups of people. What happened is the electorate, the people who have the right to vote in elections, swells from 7.7 million people to over triple that number to 24 million. So the number of people actually eligible to vote triples in size in 1918 due to this reform. It's because two things are passed. First of all, two changes are made. First of all women over the age of 30 who also own property, in other words, middle class women at the age of 30, that's what it essentially comes down to, are now given the right to vote. Additionally, all having previously never been given the right to vote of any kind, so no one could vote beforehand. Additionally, all men over the age of 21 can now vote. Previously, there were restrictions on men's voting rights based on criteria such as property. So again, it tended to be that most working class men did not have the right to vote before 1918. So you have a significant change in the demographic of the electorate itself. A much wider range of people, in particular working class males, are now able to vote more so than before. So that's the state of who's in power and that main change. And so, brief background of the main political parties at the time and what they're really all about. So on the one hand, on the first party, you've got the dominant political party of the century, you have the Conservatives. The Conservatives are traditionally seen as being the party of the middle and upper class. They tend to be dominated, the actual party itself is dominated by middle and particular upper class people, so the old aristocracy and gentry. But at the same time, they do have a substantial working class vote, sort of working class people who are who tend to be slightly more aspirational or tend to be more skilled, but also in particular, more patriotic working class people. So they do also have a working class support base. That's not their core support base. You then have the Liberals. The Liberals come out of the First World War on the face of it in really good health, having come off a really strong period of about 12 years in government, uninterrupted. However, the war years themselves were deeply divisive for the party, and that would kind of come back to haunt them in later years. The war, as we'll kind of mention several times later on in this course, when it comes to what wars do, wars tend to result in governments extending their power more so than they usually, or than they have done in the past. The First World War, like the Second World War, involves the British government adopting and taking on newer powers, greater powers, sort of control of people's lives, control over the economy, the right to sort of, you know, send letters that come out from the front, etc. And so that politic of the government deeply divides the Liberals, who traditionally are quite heavily opposed to state intervention, in particular on issues of individual liberty. And so you get a split developing between two men at the top of the party, a man called Herbert Asquith and David Lloyd George. Asquith is the Prime Minister at the beginning of the First World War, and then there is a dispute basically in the middle of the war. Lloyd George essentially, he's seen by one wing of the party to have stabbed Asquith in the back, and he takes over the party and becomes Prime Minister instead. And Asquith is basically opposed to the measures that the government was adopting in terms of greater intervention and greater powers being extended to the state during the war, for the war effort. Whereas Lloyd George was in favour of that, and so Lloyd George comes out on top and takes Asquith's place. And that spat in the middle of the war, which was results in a deep split within the party, which comes back to bite them after the First World War. So they come out of the war as a very deeply divided party, despite actually being in power and having been so for a very long time by this point. You then lastly have the newly created or still very young Labour Party, which is created in the late, right at the end of the 19th century, and they're created quite simply to represent the trade union movement. They initially created and founded as the Labour Representation Committee, and so traditionally it was meant to be a means by which workers' paying conditions could be improved. The trade union movement was basically extending its reach almost into the political into the political sphere as well. And so 1918, there's an election, and it basically is an overwhelming victory for the wartime coalition. So what happens is the Liberals and the Conservatives go into the election on the same, basically as a coalition, not going against each other. What happens actually is even though they go into the election together and they win overwhelmingly, most of the MPs are Conservative MPs, and so it's a coalition government. But this time around, though Lloyd George is still the Prime Minister, it is actually in reality dominated by the Conservatives, who the Liberals rely upon for support. So what happens to party fortunes during the First World War, or after the First World War rather? So in the decade that follows the war, the Labour Party supplants the Liberals as the official opposition in the 1922 election. That takes place, there were several elections in the 20s, and they would also go on to form two governments between 1924 and 1931. So the Liberal vote share, the Liberals never again come second in an election. After this point, always finish behind Labour and the Conservatives. Labour officially supplants them and massively increase their vote share and the number of seats they have, and they manage to form two governments in the 20s. The Liberals will never again, after 1918, take power. And in this time period, they will never again take power as the official government. They will sometimes be involved as one part of a large coalition, but very insignificant within that as well. And so they are effectively marginalised as a political force. They come out of the war being the dominant political party within the within Britain, and in less than 10 years, they're basically extinguished as a major political force. There are several reasons that can be attributed to that. Partly, it can be attributed to the Representation of the People Act. If we look at the demographics of voters we mentioned at the beginning, the Labour Party, in terms of people who are given the vote, their demographic of voter, aka unskilled working class men on lower income as well, that voter base swells massively due to the Representation of the People Act. Again, even if you consider the Conservative voter base, they also traditionally attract some working class supporters, and they also, or the vote is also extended to more middle upper class women. So again, that kind of Conservative voter base also to an extent swells. If you look at the Liberal voter base, they traditionally not really had a demographic they can rely upon as a consistent voter base who will constantly come back to them and vote for them as a political party. They tend to have some consistent support among types of middle class voters, but it's not a particularly strong one. And so what you see is actually the Liberal vote numbers, total number of votes, actually increases in the 20s, but their proportion of the vote decreases because most of the, pretty much all the new voters who come in are voting by the Conservatives or the Labour Party. And so the Liberal Party votes increase, but their vote share decreases as a proportion. Since the actual electorate itself is swelling. The other side of it as well is those aforementioned splits we talked about that came out of the First World War. The Liberal Party actually formally splits on one occasion and contests elections as two separate parties. And so as a divided party, it becomes very difficult for it to make any gains within elections. In particular, if you consider that Britain uses the first-past-the-post electoral system. First-past-the-post electoral system relies upon not vote share, but actually total number of seats in which you win. And so if your vote share gets split, you tend to lose most of your seats. Additionally, within that, if you're blaming the electoral system, the Liberal vote share, even though it drops, it still remains for quite a few elections or electoral cycles around a very healthy 20% proportion. Having said that, that 20% does not produce 20% of the seats. The Liberals are particularly affected by the electoral system, whereby you are not guaranteed the number of votes you received in terms of seats. Seats are contested on an individual basis, so actually they receive far less than their vote share receives. And so the Representation of the People Act and the rise of Labour supplants them as the opposition, but the electoral system is what really destroys their party's political voice, since they're no longer able to receive as many seats as they previously did, even though they still have quite widespread support in parts of the country. That's not replicated in Parliament. You then lastly have the Conservatives adjusting to the changing circumstances of that decade and managed to govern for most of that period. The Conservatives, I think, are in charge in the 20s for all but 2 years or 3 years. I think if McDonald comes in 1929, they're in charge for all but 2 years of that decade in some capacity. And so you've got... you've got a Conservative government led by individuals who have this knack for adapting to the political circumstances of the day. So if we take, for example, high points, which we'll come to later on in the course, high points of class tension, for example, the general strike in 1926, the Conservatives resist the temptation after it to sort of overly punish the trade unions and clamp down on them too severely, in the hope that they don't sort of create too much class tension and they don't want to be seen as a party which does that. They try to be seen as a party which unifies. And so the Conservatives, kind of as in the 20s and later on, they have this knack for adjusting to the political order of the day and using that as a survival mechanism. Again, if we look at other parts of the course, which we'll come back to later on, things like welfare reform. Although the welfare state isn't really properly created until after the Second World War, some aspects of welfare reform do begin to be introduced in the interwar period, some of which are brought in by the Conservatives, who have begun to gradually warm to the idea that actually a safety net of some kind is necessary for people in the country who are sort of struggling. And so again, this kind of adaptation allows them to sort of survive under these circumstances. So yeah, what I'll say as well is for this particular issue of party fortunes, I'm mainly focusing on to what extent party fortunes change. What I suggest you do is it can still be quite, I think, it's a quite common topic, or more likely, in fact, this topic is more like a question as to why party fortunes change. I've touched upon two or three reasons as to why that is. What I suggest you do is kind of go back through your notes, or either of the two main textbooks outline quite a good set of reasons as to why party fortunes do change. In particular, you get a question about why the Liberals decline or why Labour does so well, something along those lines. So going into the 30s. So the 30s in terms of the political climate is a very different political climate. So we've got Labour government comes in 1929 as the first time a Labour government actually has the most seats in Parliament. But by 1931, that government basically collapses due to the economic depression. Obviously, we'll go into more detail about the depression when we come to that topic. But born out of the economic depression, due to the circumstances, the King basically invites the various political parties to come together and join and take part in a national government, aka a coalition government, that involves the Conservatives, Labour and the Liberals. Having said that, the national government, despite in theory being a coalition of all the major parties, it comes to be dominated by the Conservative government, by the Conservative Party, despite initially having a Labour Prime Minister, Ramsay MacDonald. That's partly because the national government itself, although it involves Labour, the Liberals and the Conservatives, the main Labour Party actually splits away from it, and so there's actually two Labour parties at that time, and there are two Liberal parties as well, one which joins the national government, one which rejects it. So the national government faces this huge challenge of dealing with the depression. That's why it was called in the first place, to try and have some really stable government at a time when unstable government, aka during the depression, could be quite problematic. So they kind of introduced policies which we'll go into in more detail when we look at the economy, like a 10% tariff on foreign goods coming in. They seek to reduce interest rates. They also introduce a means test on things like a means test on welfare benefits. And so the main story of the 30s in terms of national government, or lack of a story in terms of why things don't change, is there is a failed threat, or they face a threat of extremism which does not manifest in the end. You've got essentially extremism on two sides potentially. You've got Oswald Mosley, who leads the British Union of Fascists, obviously on the far right, and then who try to challenge the national government in somewhat undemocratic means. And you also have the Communist Party, who obviously present an extreme far left challenge. There is a point in time where across Europe, governments are falling to extremism for a range of reasons. And so there's a time where it looks like potentially due to the crisis, or the economic crisis, Britain might also experience its own bout of extremism. However, they fail to actually achieve any mount a significant threat. So despite there being a threat of extremism, the political landscape, unlike aspects of Europe, is very... it's not particularly affected by that extremist threat. The reasons being, first of all, those groups themselves, in particular Mosley's group, lack any political or any particularly strong political organisation. And so it's very difficult to mount a challenge when, if in the case of Mosley's fascists, all they really have is Oswald Mosley himself giving speeches and attending rallies. They don't really have a very strong ground game in terms of people who can go around promote their ideas, etc. Or, for example, try to fight elections at the same time. It's very difficult to do that. It's mainly based around Mosley's personality. And the second reason is, again, you look at this in more detail when we come back to the economy, there is a gradual improvement in the economy later on in the decade, and the economy itself in large parts of the country doesn't tank that much anyway. So if you compare it to Europe, Britain doesn't really do that badly in the 1930s. And so for a traditional government, or for the traditional political establishment or landscape to be severely challenged, you would, in theory, require quite a significant economic threat to be posed. And the threat never materializes that much and it recovers by the end of the decade. So even the short, sharp rise and increase that Mosley does get then sort of fades away as well towards the end of the decade. And so you've got a situation where the national government is to an extent a change in the political landscape, then it also, that period also sees the failure of more extreme changes taking place, or the failure of more extreme threats to basically challenge or radically alter the shape of the political landscape. So there are ways in which the political landscape does change in the interwar period, and you can talk about the way in which actual party politics starts to reshape itself in terms of Labour and the Liberals swapping around, etc., and some of the policies that they start to adopt. On the flip side, though, you have the consistency or the constant of the Conservatives dominating, and of course you have the failure of political extremism to mount a significant challenge to the established order of the day. The post-war period is where the political landscape does start to shift in a slightly more significant and impactful way. So, 1945, although you have the rise of Labour governments in the interwar period, they're always minority governments, and so they never really have the ability to really carry out all the policies which they would like to. And so, Labour 1945 wins a shock landslide election. In reality, when you look back on it, there are quite a few factors that should have meant people could see it coming, but the way it was, people really didn't see it coming. Labour absolutely thrash the sitting Prime Minister Churchill, who also enjoyed quite high personal ratings. And so they managed to form a majority government. And that majority government, which the Labour Party forms, allows them to usher in a new era of politics, what they sort of call the consensus or consensus politics era. They usher in an era of consensus on main issues that really sort of key areas that both Labour and the Conservatives become committed to over the following decades. The first issue they are committed to is the idea of nationalisation, an idea which would have been thought unthinkable decades earlier. After 1945, both Labour and the Conservatives are committed to the nationalisation, or in other words, the government takeover of a range of key industries, things like coal mining, steel industry, etc., the railways. So that's the first thing that they're committed to. The second thing they're committed to is full employment. Full employment basically means that essentially every person has a job. In reality, it doesn't mean every person on the country does. There is still some unemployment, but the unemployment figures themselves are essentially negligible. And the government itself is committed to making sure that unemployment figures remain as negligible or as low as possible. And then lastly, of course, there is a consensus on the creation of a welfare state, which again we'll look at in more detail when we come on to that. But essentially creation of things like the National Health Service, government provision of universal benefits to people who are out of work, etc. And so both political parties are committed to this idea, and that's something which is kind of brought in by Labour's victory to an extent in 1945. Labour, despite ushering in that period, and despite having success in implementing that reform, their massive majority in Parliament allows them to implement almost their entire political programme. Coming out of the Second World War, they obviously struggle quite significantly with economic problems, and they have to continue with measures like rationing, which obviously began the Second World War, very unpopular measures, and austerity, so the government trying to cut back spending in some ways. And so as a result, despite their popularity initially and implementing really popular policies, they lose the 1951 election to the Conservatives. But again, in terms of the policies, it's worth remembering that the Conservatives by this stage have also adopted Labour's support for, or Labour's policies on things like the welfare state and nationalisation and full employment, etc. So when you think of Labour losing, it's because they've not lost to a party rejecting their changes, they've lost to a party who have mostly accepted them. So that's not another shift in the political landscape. The landscape has shifted towards consensus government. So you then have a long period of Conservative government, and it's worth knowing these periods, or that, what I mentioned at the beginning of the lecture in terms of the timelines. But yeah, you've got this short Labour government after the Second World War. You then have, after their defeat, Labour goes into the wilderness due to their own internal party divisions. And so for 13 years, you've got Conservative government. Britain is dominated by Conservative government. And that period of Conservative government witnesses quite widespread prosperity in terms of the creation of a consumer society. And so on the face of it, Britain does very well as an economy in the period of 1964. People individually begin to, on a wider scale, and again, as we'll look at in other sub-themes, begin to enjoy their own personal prosperity in terms of enjoyment of consumer goods, etc., and increased wages. But on the face of it, there are underlying economic problems that will kind of resurface in later years. But that Conservative government is dominated by, obviously, themselves as a government, but also kind of prosperity and successes in a range of areas. And so you very rarely in this course hear much about significant problems in the 50s and the early 60s, except for, well, things that are lying beneath the surface, but yet to really fully show their or rear their head. And that kind of applies itself across the themes, you'll notice. The following decade, so you then have a return of a Labour government in 1964, led by Harold Wilson. He sort of manages to heal Labour's political divisions to an extent. And the Conservatives have been in power for 13 years, as most governments of that length tend to do. They're suffering from sort of like political scandals. Economic issues are starting to come about, and so people are basically sick of them, and they basically lose that election. And so Wilson comes in, and he really starts to feel the effect of some of those underlying problems from the 1950s. And so economic issues begin to surface in the 60s, which again, we'll look at in more detail in the next sub-theme on the economy. What you will see is that, so that government is dominated to an extent by a failure to tackle economic issues. But at the same time, what you will notice is that much of the social changes that take place in this century, so social changes when it comes to changes in education, becoming slightly more liberal in that sense, laws that create a sort of more liberal society in terms of attitudes towards sexual behaviour, attitudes towards crime and punishment, additionally attitudes towards race relations. All of those types of laws, you will notice, they tend to take place or be passed between 64 and 1970, because that is the period of Wilson's government, which is a government that deals or seeks to deal with social issues, or has a successful record, arguably, in dealing with social issues. So you'll notice that's a common trend, that Labour government, a lot of social changes tend to happen in that period. You also tend to hear about a lot of economic issues, so that's a pattern to look out for. If at the same time, a pattern of prosperity is one to look out for in the previous government. This next government then comes in, due to issues with the trade unions, you'll note that, which we'll look at in a different sub-theme, Wilson loses the 1970 election to Ted Heath, who's a Conservative Prime Minister. And Ted Heath is the first person who tries to come in and go against the consensus. So both that Conservative government we talked about and this Wilson government are committed to the post-war political consensus, which are, as I mentioned, state intervention. State intervention, full employment, and a welfare state. Ted Heath is the first person who comes in and sort of makes an attempt to bring about an end to that, well, to that consensus. He sort of suggests things like trying to cut down the welfare bill. He suggests not to cut down the welfare bill. He suggests that state intervention should be brought back in the economy. He also kind of wants to crack down on the trade unions, which both Labour and Conservatives had been quite conciliatory within that period. However, again, the governments from now on, from the mid-60s onwards, all of them are dominated or affected by economic problems. And then, again, you'll see this more in the next sub-theme. There is a consistent failure to sort of deal very effectively with economic issues. And so Heath is one of those governments that gets undermined by economic problems and also the international economic situation. He's also faced a problem of industrial unrest. Industrial unrest really undermines and destroys his government, literally, and brings them down in the mid-70s. So then, you then finally, the last government to come in this post-war period is a final Labour government that comes in 1974 under Harold Wilson. Wilson switches around in 1976. He steps down and Jim Callaghan becomes Prime Minister instead. So you've got this final 5 years of Labour rule. Once again, very similar to Ted Heath, there are the same set of patterns in that government. It's the government that really gets brought down or gets substantially affected by economic crisis of the day, and also what comes along with that are issues with the unions rearing their head once again. And so you find that that's a government that struggles to deal with the same issues that Heath struggled with, and they get brought down finally in 1979, and they're defeated by Margaret Thatcher. So the rise of Thatcher, which is where the political, of course, basically ends in terms of the main side of it, that's where the personal consensus really comes to an end. Thatcher comes in, and she kind of shatters and sort of brings to an end, promising to bring to an end the personal consensus, and that is what she does. And so that's kind of a brief overview of party politics in that period. In terms of the things to focus on, as I said, the main focus tends to be either the extent to which the political landscape changes. If there's an interwar question, then I think the focus would be more on issues internal to this sub-theme, aka the things I talked about in terms of extremist challenges, the switch between Labour and the Liberals. If it's a question on changing political landscape or something about consensus after the Second World War, you need to think of that a little bit more as more of a synoptic topic, in the sense that a lot of the things you can talk about and the way to think about that when you're planning it, you can to an extent bring in aspects of different sub-themes, in particular, the other two sub-themes in theme one, so industrial unrest and economic challenges, but also others as well. I also think it's very likely, or more likely, that you can get a question in this sub-theme, a causation question. If you do get it, I think it'd be much more likely to be in that interwar period. Or you might not get a question about politics full stop, but if you do, I think they do quite like to have questions either about the reasons as to why political landscape changes, or maybe the reasons why Labour goes into decline, or something along those lines. So then we'll leave that one, that as an overview.